That's light. And this is volume. And yep.
Would you like me to bring them?
Okay.
We're good.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning.
I'm glad we're back into the sanctuary again. Oh, come, let us sing unto our God. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. We come, O God, into your presence with thanksgiving, rejoicing with songs and praise. As most of us know, we are a joint UCC and a VOC congregation, and we welcome everyone in our presence. With that, Shane.
For announcements, I have the vendor fair has been canceled for this year. We can try it again next summer. Just there's no way to do it social distancing wise without and still be covered by our insurance. That's the only announcement that I have. Does anyone else have an announcement?
Just thank you so much for making this possible.
Josiah, I think you're next. Can we turn the thing up?
Is that little white church that your family sees? The one you find yourself at every Christmas Eve. It's a place no one knows where God is dark. But it's the one who will his heart. Come, come with a broken heart. Others know the best they've heard us for. But all the love can breathe. There's no place they'd rather be. Share the small town of and you are the princess of this world. You are the princess of this world. There's no place here after.
I adapted today's invocation from a prayer I found on the Social Justice Resource Center website. Please pray with me. For all those who have fallen victim to hatred and inhumanity, for those loved ones who are left behind to mourn, for the souls of those whose hearts are cold, Lord, hear our prayer. For the children who are being born into this world of conflict and violence, for women and mothers who suffer needlessly, Lord, hear our prayer. For all those who have been forced into unemployment, who long to return to work, for all those who struggle to support their families, Lord, hear our prayer. For the officers who are misguided into thinking their bullets will bring about peace, for those who feel called to conscientiously object to chain of command orders, Lord, hear our prayer. For the children who cry in their beds at night and wonder, what have I done? For the mothers and fathers who must try to explain the unexplainable, Lord, hear our prayer. For all the children who have died before their time, for the soldiers and law enforcement officers who allow their uniform to strip them of humanity, for the healers who are denied the opportunity to use their gifts, Lord, hear our prayer. For the redemption of souls, both victim and perpetrator, for those who commit themselves to the forgiveness of sins, Lord, hear our prayer. Amen.
Amen. Good morning.
Great to see everybody. Annie has now joined us. Annie Cooper has now joined us via the Zoom. So we have two people via the Zoom. It's been a while since we've seen one another. I think it's really great to come back together and to see smiling faces again. I've learned to appreciate technology in a different way, but I can tell you quite frankly, I'm sick and tired of Zoom services. It's wonderful, but it has its issues. I want to start out with just a real short, it's not really funny, but I think it kind of illustrates kind of the frustration in which we kind of catch ourselves. It's a kind of simple form of it. It has been a long time, 7 years to be exact, since Brian had been to see his doctor. So the nurse told him that if you want to make an appointment, you will have to be reprocessed as a new patient. Okay, said Brian, reprocess me. I'm sorry, she said. We are not accepting new patients. I think that kind of illustrates somewhat the frustration that a lot of us feel. It's not an easy thing to get through socially distancing and the issue of coronavirus. But I think we're going to survive okay. But a lot of people have suffered. There's no question about it. There's a lot of people suffering and still are. I chose the title from an article that I had for some time that somebody sent me from USA Today newspaper. It was written in April. And I think it, I've been holding off on using it over Zoom because I think it has a lot of discussion and debate that can be issued or to have because it has a variety of opinions. And I chose the title, If God Didn't Do It, Who Did? And that came from this article has four different responses thereabouts from four different people of clergy on over the issue of the coronavirus. And the last person, who happened to be a rabbi, said that she didn't think that the coronavirus was created by God, but God, she saw God in all the acts that are becoming because of it, people helping one another. And so thus the title, If God Didn't Do It, Who Did? I chose the Hebrew reading, or a reading out of Hebrews, Hebrews 2, somewhere around 5 or so, in which it refers to that all things have not yet been put under Christ. So I'm going to read a couple verses. It is not to angels that he has subjected the world to come, about which we are speaking. But there is a place where someone has testified. What is man that thou art mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him. You made him a little lower than the angels, and you crowned him with glory and honor, and you put everything under his feet. In putting everything under him, being Christ, God left nothing that is not subject to Christ. Yet at present, we do not see everything subject to Christ. And I will stop at that point right there. And the question that arises out of this text and many times throughout my life, reading it, is, well, if it isn't subject to God, then who is it? There are other references throughout the Bible referring to that. And one of them is in Psalms. If you care to read it, 110, I'll just read one a verse. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. And it goes on to say. So that text also is a very controversial text because of the very beginning. The Lord said to my Lord. So here, all things, rather than saying all things, it refers to as enemies, plural enemies. So how do we see the coronavirus? And I'm gonna start off with the article and then I'm gonna, at the end, I'll have my own, or give a biblical way I kind of see it, or way we wanna go, or the way we'll open it up for discussion. And this article is entitled, Is the coronas an act of God? Faith leaders debate the tough questions amid the pandemic. And it starts out with an Islam imam, a preacher, who started out his message by saying, thank God for the coronavirus. And he saw the coronavirus as a means or a way of driving people back to faith. He says, thank God for this as a reminder that we are not in control and must always be dependent on God. Thank God for this reminder that we should be grateful for all things, for groceries, for toilet paper, and for good health. Thank God for reminding us life is fragile, and we must appreciate the miracle and the blessing that God has given us in creation of us as souls. So he sees it as a way in which would drive people back into a more religious experience and to have maybe appreciate things much more. The second one, he goes on to say, I'll continue on just a little bit more of what he had to say. He says that Islam, and within Islam, that the coronavirus should not be seen necessarily only as a test of our faith, but a means of solidifying our faith and making it more solid. Even though we are in difficult times and our faith are being challenged, we should know that. We should know that our faith at some point in time is going to be challenged along the way. He says, the Quran says the trials will come and that we should be prepared for them. So how do we react? Do we go off and hoard toilet paper? Which has happened in the beginning of this whole pandemic. People went off, which I never quite understood why paper issues was one of their top issues that everybody ran running off the shelf. Yeah, I understand, but still, of all things. We are to take care of others in the midst of these trials, I think he goes on to say. And I believe that to be true. I'm not going to give an answer, and neither is anyone here in this article going to actually give an answer to the question. It's meant to make us think. So the next one is an ascetic Jew out of Bozeman, Montana, who was really shaken by the whole thing because he had some people in his family and uncles and whatnot in New York City who were sick and ill. But he was in Bozeman, Montana. And he says, how do I get through this and maintain my faith in God? He raises the question, why does God allow this to start off? He has an uncle, three uncles who tested positive, and he was quite frankly overwhelmed by the whole situation. And he normally prays three times a day or at set times of the day. And his daughter noticed that he wasn't doing that. And he said, basically, he says, I need a break from God. I need to contemplate. He says, probably for the first time in my life, I wasn't praying because that was the order of the day.
And she's
it wasn't just a normal thing to do. He couldn't just do the ordinary things of the day.
And I stayed in water.
He says, I told her the order of the, told my daughter, his daughter, that the order of the day, and that I couldn't do the order of the day, and that it was a kind of a holiday. He says, I told her I needed to find this moment with God. I needed to talk to him a bit. So he's seen it as a time in which he had to just really rethink things. How do we justify a loving God in the midst of all this? So he says, we always say that we're supposed to be thankful for every breath we take, and we're supposed to give thanks for that. And he said, that's a very cute concept. And I think that is kind of a sound bite. But he says, in the last few weeks, it has really become real. You know, just to take that breath in and out. And sometimes I think we forget that life is that simple. It's an in and out breath. A pause. We forget. In the clutter of our life, we forget. He says, for centuries, suffering has, he points out that suffering has happened to all sorts of people. But he says he doesn't really know why, the why behind this particular suffering. He says he's not, his job is not to be God's lawyer, but to be his salesperson. So he believed that the greatest thing that we could do was encourage one another again, and to love our neighbors, ourselves, and to care for one another. The second one, or the third one, is probably a little more in depth as a Christian point of view, because we have quite a few different views as to why suffering and happens, and in the midst of a good God who's loving, but yet allows suffering. We want to put everything under one umbrella and see that God either allows it and for our for various different reasons. And this gentleman who is out in Idaho, he said he's been really busy. He does a lot of Zoom conferencing, which we all are getting used to. And he tried to answer the question, if God is good, then why does coronavirus exist? And he said there is a lot of really good, bad, really good, bad answers. There's a lot of really good, bad answers to this question that are out. And I guess you could say good, bad questions. I don't know. That's kind of redundant. But it's bad questions, bad answers. And I agree with them. I think of all the faiths that are out there, there are some in the Christian faith, I think sometimes we have some of the least answers of why things, bad things happen to good people. And he said the first group, he divides them up into, I think, four different groups, or several different groups. He said the first group says that God is angry about sin, or gays, or lesbians, or whatever. And he says that God is using this to punish. And he sees this as God sees it as, you know, you do bad things, you're going to get punished. And so because people have wandered off the trail, according to these people's trail, of what is considered to be good Christians, God is punishing us. And that's probably one of the, I would say, variations of that is what is accepted widely within the Christian faith. You can't hardly get away from that. Within the Christian faith. I don't agree with that, but that nevertheless, that's what it is. But he says, God is a God of love, and he's not in the business of doing evil. So next comes the group that says that God hasn't caused the natural evil, but allows it to happen. So in other words, he could stop it, but he don't. Or she don't, whichever you want to say. So that group says, yes, God has the power to do it, but he's not going to do anything about it. He's just going to let it happen. I think that's kind of an empty way of looking at it, too. He says, this doesn't make any kind of logical sense. Letting something horrible happen goes against God's nature. And I tend to agree with that. He said, then there's a third group who says that they just chalk it up to a mystery. They just don't have any idea why it happens. I guess, I don't know. I think it can be a little more understood than that. And then in his teaching, he presents the fourth option. He said, God can't simply prevent the coronavirus or any other natural evil single-handedly, but requires our participation and cooperation to fight it. This is his explanation as to why bad things happen. That God can't simply prevent it, but we are supposed to, in the effort of all this struggle, we are to show God's love. He says, I don't think God is in the business of punishing or harming but the most vulnerable people and the people of the margins. But he does believe that God is omnipotent, but not in what he calls the classical view. He can't put a square make a square round. Or he can't put a round peg in a square hole. So there is some things that God can't do the way he sees. And again, he goes on to say that the church is supposed to take care of the marginal people, which I agree. Then there are some people who saw it as, because this happened over Passover and Easter, that they use the analogy of, well, this is a time of we are fleeing from the plague. It's like an escape, or they made the analogy to Passover and Moses leading the children of Israel out into the desert and away from the plague. And he says, I think the big question here is, how do we give a sense of hope in the midst of this? Of all these different things, how do we give a sense of hope? What is the last word in coronavirus? I have one more person. And for the Christian, or for the person who believes in life hereafter, or in the resurrection, or the spiritual people, we believe in life hereafter. So death doesn't have the final answer. So neither does coronavirus. Neither of the things are alive. Then the last person, who I mentioned in the beginning, she is known as a Twitter rabbi, because she has a blog or a platform on the social media. And she's been busy trying to answer all kinds of questions about coronavirus and God's punishment and unleashing the plagues in this point in time. And people want to make meaning in the time of fear and uncertainty and suffering. And that is totally understandable and natural, she says. But she says, I don't put the analogy that it's a time that can relate to the Passover. She doesn't get that picture, and she doesn't. Being a Jew, she doesn't want to see that analogy. She doesn't like that analogy. She said, I don't think God is smiting us. My theology does not involve a man in the sky with a pair of dices and saying, it's smite the people o'clock. And that's not how I understand what God is. So basically she's saying, God is gonna roll some dice and you happen to get the short end of the dice and you're gonna get punished. She says, I don't see God that way. She goes on to say that we have free will, which is an argument and a debate and a theological issue on itself. I believe we have the freedom to choose, but I don't know how free our will is. But nevertheless, she believes that there is such a thing as free will, and that we are given choice. That we can decide whether or not we want to social isolate ourselves, or we want to practice social distancing, or that we want to go recklessly and let the virus spread. We have decisions that we can make, she said. We have choices that we can make. And so, in the midst of this, she finds help and solace in the Talmud. She said, she goes on to quote, she says, since the day the temple was destroyed, the gates of prayer are locked. Now, I do think that the gates of prayer was the golden gates, which we had a message on a while back, which are locked up, closed shut, in the walls over in Jerusalem. So I think she's referring to those gates, or that particular gate. Because at some particular time in the future, when Christ returns, that gate is supposed to be open. That's another whole theological perspective. But she says, though the gates of prayer are locked, the gates of tears are not locked. And she says that we can all continually cry to God in the times of heartache. And there is still powerful ways to connect spiritually. Although uncertainty abounds, she still finds hope. How do we see, and how do we understand this? Do we even bother to ask the question?
I'm laughing back here, but I'm not really laughing at the coronavirus. It's just there are so many conspiracy theories about why it happened.
Why what?
Why the virus was made, why it was sent out to infect everyone.
Okay, I'll give you my angle and you can do with it what you want. Viruses have been with us ever since life has been around. They are either a byproduct of life or they help create life. This is what science is telling us. So they've been around. There's some 5,000 of them that we have named, that we know. Granted, they mutate and there's a lot of different ones. My opinion is it's a natural virus that may have been used by a particular country for some reason. Change in agreement. Now, could it have been, is it being used in other methods and other reality, you know, other things happening because of it and people taking advantage of it? Yes, I do agree with that. I want to refer to something in, come at it at a little bit different angle. And in Matthew 13, there are several parables about different types of soil. You can read a parable of the sower, a couple different ones. I want to look at the idea of the soil, the dust, the clay was corrupted right from the start. I'm watching them. Oh, yes. I want to come at the angle of that the soil,
you didn't get
the
my
dust
you did.
That we were created from, carried with it,
and
what do you call it, bacteria,
not the dinner.
What do they call that?
Life.
I should have wrote that word down. But it carried with it life within it. So if we were created from clay and dust of the earth, I have to say clay and dust, then all of that stuff that was created before us is now in the soil. Now I'm going to give an evolutionary viewpoint of this also. So if you believe in creationism, you believe that God or gods, Elohim, took clay, and clay as a living form of life of some sort, it has life in it, clay. You take a clay pack and you put it on your face and it's supposed to have good enzymes and all this kind of stuff in it. And so clay has life forms in it. So we were created out of that and the breath of life was put into us. So nowhere does it say that the clay was sterile, that there was no life in it. It was used out of the earth, which carried with it all the bacteria and the small life, I wish I could think of that word that I'm trying to think of, the small bacterial life. Some days it's just, anyway, that created the beginning of life.
I thought we did.
So that was already distilled in us. And this is where disease and the coronavirus and all of this stuff still lives in our body because of this story. Now, if you're a strict evolutionist, the evolutionists say that life was created from rocks and the minerals joining together. I want to say amoebic life, but I don't know, that's not quite the word that I want. But that created small life, amoebic life. I can't think of the word that I want to use. And that's where life started. Life started on this earth because of a combination of the two, and thus life evolved up through. So even if you take that evolutionary, strictly evolutionary point of view, we still have remnants of our past in us. We still have all those bacteria, which we have in order to have life. We cannot live in a sterile world. We'll get sick and die. We have to have all this bacteria and these viruses and all many, many good ones. So out of that chain of life, we still retain these things. And thus, the coronavirus is a natural virus that comes out of the long trail of either evolutionary life or creation, however you want to see it. And so we are continually going to have these things at some point in time along the way. We're not going to get away from any of this. We have a long history of pandemics of some sort. Virus infections and cold, I mean, a whole load of things. So if you think this is going to be the last one, you're wrong. They're only going to probably get worse. So I want to see, I want to look at it from that point of view. So who created and created the order to make stones? We'll take the evolutionary process first. To take stones and minerals, and thus the combination come together and makes life. That's where I see God. Who designed the design? Who created the process, you know, making these things do what they do? Why does it that when rocks and minerals come together, life starts? Who wrote that program to say that that does that? There's where I see God at. Somebody wrote that. Some God, some power far beyond us wrote why that happens. Why does the wind, when it blows, starts with a little butterfly and over here is a tornado? Who wrote that program? Why does that do? Why do, when I put a seed in the ground and it's dry and it grows? Who wrote that program? There's where God is for me. Yes, go ahead. That's why?
God upstairs.
Yeah, upstairs, however you want to say it. The God is all around us. The energy that's all around us, as we talked about the Holy Spirit at Pentecost last week, that energy force, that life force is everywhere we are. And that to me is where God is. I can't close this message without saying something about the struggle we're having now with the protests and what had. My simple, not really simple, I think that we need to change the way we do policing. Now, the simple example I told Colleen was, and I told Bob and Carol, when I come across the difference between crossing this border and going into Canada is sightfully different. When I go into Canada, they treat me like I'm a person. They know, as I, my track, yeah, I've been told many times that as I drive up to the booth, they know more about me in that short time than I can remember. I've been told that. They know all about you before you get there. So the difference between going into Canada and being treated like a person and coming back into my country is starkly two different things. I'll guarantee you, 99% of the time when I come back to this country, I get treated like a piece of dirt. You get yelled at, you get all kinds of, they're just nasty. So that's a reflection to me on the policing issue. I think in my, and I'm not African American, I'm not, I'm a white man. So I can't put myself in a brown situation. But I can only imagine that this is what's going on in a lot of times. I am the law. I can do whatever I want, whenever I want. And I think people are sick and tired. And they, yes, Bob.
Perfect illustration of that, and I love your analogy. The perfect illustration of that is on one occasion, Carol and I go up with the Hamilton Gibson group. Canada's play. And on one occasion, the guard on the American side, when we were coming back, got on the bus and said, "Who's in charge here?" And so the organizer our group said, I am. And this enforcement officer says, wrong, I am. And that's how I think, that's how I'm guessing a lot of African-American people feel, and yes. Other people.
Yes.
And it was such a perfect illustrative example. You go into Canada, and you're in very way greeted with good morning, good afternoon.
Yes.
And you come back into the States, and you face usually a sullen individual who doesn't say anything. And it's a very, very different experience.
Yes. So I can only imagine what's happening in the inner cities. I can only imagine. And I'm not here to derate the police force. I think we need policing, but we need a different type of policing.
When he talks about the sullen attitude in retail, and I taught my daughter this, when someone comes through the door, it doesn't matter if you've had a bad day, a horrible day, nothing matters. Forget all that. Smile and be polite. And in many cases, the police may know that that works in most cases, but they are also, as you said, they think of themselves as better than anyone else. And that they know and you don't. And so their concept is, you listen to me, and it doesn't matter what you think.
Go ahead.
One of the things I've often told Gary, if we ever get stopped at a DUI checkpoint, I'm driving, and they want me to walk the line.
You're drunk.
Hey, Calvin. I have a comment too about something you mentioned early on in the talk, which was people buying and hoarding all that toilet paper. And you kind of ask, why do they do that? Well, my answer is because they're full of what they need that toilet paper for.
Thank you, Janie.
Oh, totally welcome. I'm glad people can't really see me except maybe you.
And again, I don't want to beat up on the police force. I think they have a terrible job to do. They do. But the incident down in Louisville where they went in at 2:00, because they can go unannounced, and this particular person had a drug offense against them. And they went in at 2:00, rammed the door down, and then wondered why they get the action. They didn't end up shooting an innocent woman. Why? And I tell you, I see more people of color being pulled over along the side of the road and searched than I see white people for many years. So again, we need policing, and they have a terrible job to do, and they are not all bad. But there needs to be some changes in the attitudes in which they approach people. And you know, we are human beings. We're not criminals. And my analogy of they understand me when I come across the border, they know exactly where I come. They know what my whole history. I've been told many times. I know that there was no problem. One time when I was crossing the Canadian side, they said, we know there's no problem with you, but we have to do our job. We have to go. You look through your truck and do all. I said, that's fine. Do whatever you got to do, that's fine. But they already knew that I had no problems. So they know. I think there's also a disparity in the wages. Wages is another thing. Healthcare, mental health care, and wages. I think people, I've over the years, I have talked to tons and tons of people. The people I deal with, I go in the back door where the people are working, the working people. And over the years, they have told me many, many times, the steady decline of wages, benefits keep coming down, while the rich guy at the top is getting more and more. I think there's a huge disparity between the two. My correction of that is there needs to be a formula made that the CEO cannot make more, a percentage more than the lowest paid employee, but then it requires regulation. But why can't the workers share in the wealth of the company? And the rich can get rich. There's plenty to go around. I mean, the rich can get rich, and that's fine. I'm not against rich people. That's fine. That's great. No problem. Success, entrepreneurship, and free enterprise is a great engine, but it needs to take more on morals and ethics. It must take on morals and ethics. Because you can do something, it doesn't make it right that you can. We have to do some changes.
Oh, one other thing. And I keep wearing my all means all shirt. Can you see it? And I really appreciate the chalice on the back that includes many of whom all includes. And I appreciate that our church seems to know and remember that. That when Christ says all, He really means all. And it's not up to us to set limits.
Thank you, Jamie. I think we talk about justice. People are looking for justice. That's another thing that irritates me a little bit. Yes, we haven't even gotten to the point where we have justice. Fair for a crime, you do this. We haven't even gotten to that point yet, let alone forgiveness, grace, and mercy. We as a humanity have a ways to go. We do. We have a long way to go. We call ourselves Christians, but we don't even hardly talk about forgiveness, grace, and mercy. We're still stuck on justice and revenge. I want justice. I want that policeman to suffer as much as I can. What happened to forgiveness, grace, and mercy so we can mend? Yes, sir. Does making that police person who did that suffer as hard as what the crime he committed, is that going to solve anything? Is that going to make you feel better? Is that going to make you heal? At some point in time, it has to be forgiveness, grace, and mercy. We need to sit down and communicate and talk and share our different points of view. We are different. Just because I don't fit in this square window, I might fit in this square window, it doesn't make me any less. It just makes me different. And I think there's a failure of all of us in some degree, a failure to understand that person that's in that other window. That's different. And we need to develop forgiveness, grace, and mercy. We have to learn, not tolerance, forgiveness, grace, and mercy. And with that, I'll say amen. We do a communion first. Does everyone have a that one's super tank?
Does anyone need one?
Yes.
Okay, stay seated in the offering.
Everyone, we put no restrictions on the Lord's table. The Lord's table is a personal relationship between you and God, and there you can commune. And so let us remember on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread and he broke it and he said to his disciples, "Eat all of you, for this represents my body broken for all. May our sins be forgiven." And again,
Jesus took a chalice and he poured some wine into it and said to his disciples, drink, all of you, for this is my life poured out and given for all. A new life. Help us, O God, to live this new life. We are commanded by Jesus, as often as we eat this meal, to remember and to reflect on God's goodnesses and mercies. In God's Holy Spirit, we are to share this meal together as we gather until the time we can eat this meal, each one of us, face to face with our Lord. May we partake. Concerns? Does anyone have any? We'll start off with the concerns.
well, concern for this country and the use of police force, which too often has been unrestrained.
Concern, Traveler's Mercy's faith for my family. My daughter will be coming up from downstate, and my daughter-in-law and granddaughter will be traveling down from upstate New York next week for a family baby shower for my granddaughter, Sydney. Most of us aren't used to traveling anymore.
For our son-in-law, Johnny, and our granddaughter, Gary, they're now in the building out of control of the financial involved. And they're buildings are like.
Did everybody hear that? Our son-in-law and our granddaughter is in the National Guard, and they got called up last week to go to Philly to riot control. But they need our prayers.
Who was that?
That's Connie and I's son-in-law and our granddaughter. Oh. We're both in the National Guard. Yes.
Thank you.
Concern for the protesters everywhere, that they be safe.
Yes.
And he said about the protesters for being safe. I don't know if anybody can hear all that. Anything else on the concerns? How about joys? Sure, we got some joys. Let's lift our hearts and say some joy.
I do. It's a joy to be able to join you from afar. It's a joy to thank Shane for being a big part of making this possible. And of course, it's a real joy to see Annie.
I'm glad to see you too, Jeannie. You're okay.
Living at Country Terrace, but they're taking good care.
Great.
I'll be glad when things open up. Maybe somebody can come and visit me sometime.
I'm glad to be back in the village. Yeah, so we're yes. Sanctuary was the word I was looking for.
And I always want to thank Meg for the care she takes of those feral cats.
I was able to trap 5 kittens about 6 weeks old and fostering them, and I started a fundraiser to money towards them, and they've asked for the care so far. They're going to be going down to Jersey.
I couldn't hear all you said. What did she say, Calvin? I couldn't hear all that Meg said.
Calvin, frozen.
She's thankful that Ian, you graduated.
Yes, I did. I officially graduated yesterday, which was a joy. We were so glad we passed the lot.
Yes, congratulations.
Thank you, Gene.
So are you kicked out of the house now?
No, not until the end of July.
Not until the end of July?
Yeah, so I'm off to college.
Oh, you're off to college. Where are you going?
Lycoming College for pre-law and criminal justice.
Where?
Lycoming College.
Oh.
Any other questions?
Virtually or really?
Really. We'll actually be on campus all semester.
Great. Good luck.
Really glad about it.
I'm thankful for the restaurants opening up, and I don't have to eat groceries no more.
And I'm sad that Grandma's Kitchen isn't going to.
Yeah, that is sad. Okay, any others? Let us join.
Calvin, one more thing. I know that a few bad policemen have been proven to be a problem. However, I also know several that speak of the treatment they receive at the hands of their prisoners or people they are attempting to arrest. So, a prayer for the safety of the officers.
I am going to pray for them, yes. They have a very difficult job. I mean, I agree. And I don't think, again, they're not all bad, that's for sure. And we definitely need policing in this one. I mean, there's no question about it.
That's why the bad ones make news.
The good ones don't. Anything else? Let us join our hearts together, hearts and minds together in prayer. Lord Jesus, look with your tender mercy upon the multitudes of our day who bear the indignities of injustice everywhere. Lift up leaders in every land dedicated to your standards of order, equality, and justice. Grant us, Lord Jesus, the grace to be worthy members of your mystical body, laboring unceasingly to fulfill our vocation in the societies apostolic of your church. Sharpen our intelligence to pierce the pettiness of prejudice, to perceive the beauty of the true human brotherhood and sisterhood. Guide our minds to a meaningful understanding of the problems of the poor and of the oppressed and of the unemployed, of all in need of assistance everywhere. Guide our hearts against the subtle lure of earthly things and the undue regard for those who possess them. May we hunger and thirst after your justice and your forgiveness and mercy, grace and mercy. We ask this in Jesus' name. Lord, be with this church. Lord, be with churches all around as we start to reopening. There is a lot of uneasiness some places. We're worried and kind of stressed out as we come back together. Help us to relax and to enjoy the church and one another. Help us to social distance. Help us to do what is necessary for each person so that they can live a life flourishingly. Until we get through this time, may we be patient with one another. Lord, I ask you to be with this nation, our leaders who make decisions. There's a lot of misinformation going around. Help us to be patient. Help us not to be a part of the problem, but help us to look for solutions. Help us to look a little deeper than just a simple word that's being published. Help us to look and give a helping hand. Lord, I ask you to be with the protesters as they protest peacefully. I pray that there's no violence, but the strength of peace will rise forward and the spirit of peace will be lifted up. We do need changes. We can change. Help us to work together and not pull apart. There are many people who are watching over us. Lord, I ask you to be with all our police people. Lord, they have a tough job. help them and give them patience. Not to be violent, but look for another way. Turn the other cheek and look for another way. Both the protesters and the police people. We can work together and have our voices heard. The fire people, EMT people. There's a lot of people who really care, the nurses and the doctors who have carried us through this time of COVID. Many have died and lost their lives in the process of helping others. But I ask you a special grace upon your family. Lord, just be with them. There are things that we are all concerned about. We're a little uneasy. Help us to give us a steady hand and a steady mind. Help us to be aware of our surroundings and not to be so quick to be judgmental of others. Help us to look past justice and say, and look for forgiveness, grace, and mercy wherever we can apply it. It's a journey. Help us to move in that direction. There are those who are not with us. Be with them wherever they're at. Bless them. We are thankful, and we have a lot of things to be thankful and joyful about. One of them is Ian, who has now graduated and goes off to college. He is going to participate in the world around him. He's going to lift up the world and do his part. Lord, I ask a special blessing on his mind and his heart to be with his parents and his family. Watch over him and bless him. Connie, who is asking for safe travel for her family, for all of us who travel, myself included, it's an uneasy time. But I ask you to be with my son, our son-in-law, my son-in-law, and our granddaughter. Watch over their actions and their minds and their thoughts as they, again, protect from the violence. It's a tough, tough job. Be with all the National Guard as they stand in the breach and protect and watch over. We're thankful for the technology of Zoom, for Annie and Jeannie who is with us. We are especially joyful to be once again back in the sanctuary. It's wonderful to see each person. Bless each one who is here and who is not here. Yes, it's in Jesus' name. Join me now in the Lord's Prayer. Loving God
in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come, thy will be done, earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, and forgive those who trespass against us.
Save us from the time of trial. Lead us not
into temptation. Deliver us from evil.
Yours is the kingdom,
power,
and the glory
forever. Amen.
Oh, Calvin. Hey, Calvin. Hello. I have one more request. Please keep the Caribbean coast, the Gulf Coast, in your prayers as they're expecting this storm.
The storm, the Caribbean coast. That's something.
It's coming this way.
Yes, and of course, especially it's in New Orleans too.
Yes.
So Florida and the whole Gulf Coast.
So I think may God's grace be go with each one of us, and may we smile as we walk through our lives. Go in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
You are
so good to see you.